Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming out on a Tuesday night on kind of short notice. Welcome to Can He Do That? A conversation on the constitutionality of the recent executive orders presented by the Muslim Law Students Association, Outlaw, and with the generous sponsorship and help of the Duke Bar Association. I'd first like to thank all of our panelists for responding on very short notice to join us tonight, and thank all of you for coming as well. This event was kind of inspired Saturday night for me when a friend that I went to college with, a very dear friend, asked, you know, in my living room, can he even do that? And no one told Professor Powell, but I didn't know how to respond to that. I knew where to start going with a constitutional analysis to say, well, look at the power and the authorization, but I didn't actually know where I was going to go with it. It was just so overwhelming. So with that inspiration and the efforts of a lot of people responding in their emails very quickly the past few days, we'd like to present with you with this panel. As a heads up, the first 30 minutes or so are going to be recorded and available to the public online. We will make a clear announcement when the recording is going to stop for anyone who is concerned about their privacy or would like to be able to discuss different aspects but doesn't want them recorded for the general public. Also at 8 o'clock, we will announce who the new Supreme Court nominee is per the Twitter announcement we all received. So don't feel like you have to sacrifice active engagement and participation to find out on your computers or your phones. We will tell you. So otherwise, thank you all for coming, and please give our panel a hand.
All right, good evening. My name is Guy Charles. I'm a law professor here. So I want to say a few things. First, I want to start off by congratulating the student organizers. It is pretty amazing of you all to do this on such short notice. And to serve as a locus of organizing an intellectual community to respond to a very important issue. So if we could just start by giving these folks a hand, because I think this is a tremendous undertaking. And of course, all of you ought to be congratulated. As difficult as this time is, I have to say that I am enormously proud to be a lawyer. Usually I have doctor envy, right? There's an earthquake and you're the lawyer and you're kind of like, well, I'd like to file a lawsuit, but that's not gonna help get this brick off this person's leg. But this is a moment in which, for good or ill, the lawyers show up and the lawyers showed up. And we're so tremendously proud of you this evening for showing up to help us think through and to figure out, really, can he do that, and what does the law have to say about that? We have an amazing and tremendous panel. I apologize for their maleness and whiteness, but it's the best that we could do on short notice. So if you know me, you know that I would have to say something like that because you're all thinking it, and so let's just verbalize that. Okay, so apologies, but they are tremendously amazing. We're going to start off with Professor Chris Schroeder, followed by Walter Dellinger, my favorite friend, Neil Siegel. Yes, I did beat him up. And we're going to have Professor David Schanzer from the Public Policy School. Last but of course not least is our favorite 15-year-old, is Professor Stephen Sachs. Of course, he looks young, but he's actually over 25. Obviously very brilliant. So we'll have a first round in that order. They'll open up for 7 minutes thinking about the constitutionality, starting broad and then coming down narrowly. And then they'll do another quick round with some interactions, and then we'll open it up to you to spend the rest of the time so we could have a conversation. And my role simply is to serve as cruise director, which is a role that I take fairly seriously. So let us begin, Chris.
Thank you very much, Guy, I think, for that introduction. I'm going to say a few quick words about how to think about executive orders in general, how to think about their legality, and then this executive order in particular. So all presidents use executive orders, particularly in the modern era. Bill Clinton sort of invigorated this art form of presidential action emanating from the White House with a document that says executive order on the top as a way to announce what he was going to do, articulated in a way that could be clearly understood both by people in the public and by everybody who worked for him. So you could be in the bowels of the Department of Homeland Security and you knew exactly what the president's policy was when he signed an executive order. And also to claim credit for things. Presidents like to claim credit for their actions, and actions coming out of an agency are one step removed from coming out of the pen of the President of the United States. Having said that Bill Clinton invigorated the art form, they've been used by presidents down through time. You can tell that by the numbering system. We're in the 13,000s of executive orders under the modern numbering system. Clinton issued 360-odd of them. His predecessor, George Herbert Walker Bush, was more modest. He did about 165. But since Bill Clinton, it's been about 300 for anybody who's been in the White House for 8 years. That's George W. Bush and Barack Obama, and we ought to expect about that number coming out of President Trump as well if he serves for 8 years. Maybe more. A lot of them are issued in the first year of a presidency, which sort of makes sense because with very few exceptions in the post-World War II era, presidents of one party have been succeeded by a president from the other party. So the other party comes in with a lot of pent-up policy initiatives that they would like to see done that have been thwarted by virtue of the fact that the preceding president was from had a different point of view or policies that they would like to see overturned, like the Affordable Care Act, to name one contemporary example. So in the first year of Barack Obama's presidency, he issued 40 executive orders. In the first year of George W. Bush's, he issued 51. I think we're up to 5 or 6 by President Trump. There's more coming. Now, how to think about their legality? Well, in the same way you need to think about the legality of any executive action. There's nothing particular about the label executive order. There are presidential memoranda, there are presidential policy directives, there are presidential decision directives. There are presidents picking up the phone and telling the cabinet secretary what to do. These are all executive actions. And under our system of separated powers, they have to be justified in one of two ways. They either have to be justified on the basis of the authority of a statute, or they have to be justified on the basis of the authority of some power that's been vested in the president through Article 2 of the Constitution, such as the power to pardon or the power to recognize, receive ambassadors, or the foreign affairs power, which is a much vaguer power, or the commander-in-chief power. So you have to find some positive grant of authority. No one pretends that by executive order, President Trump could abandon the Clean Air Act. That's a statute. It takes an act of Congress to do that. But there are lots of things that presidents can do under statutes, pursuant to statutes. And there, what they're doing is a kind of standard presidential function. They're executing the laws. So that's probably the most common justification for for executive actions, is the president is executing the laws. And the second one is they're acting under their unilateral constitutional authority. Then the third question you would have to ask is whether there are aspects of the Constitution limiting the authorities of the president or the government as a whole that says, no, 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 you can't do that, like the Equal Protection Clause or the Establishment Clause, which may put a constraint on you even if the statute would otherwise authorize the activity. So what's going on in this case? What President Trump has done is placed a stay on entry from 7 countries and ordered a lid put on the number of refugees entering the country and ordered lots of studies of the vetting process for issuing visas in throughout the system, but particularly targeted at areas in which he claims we need extreme vetting. So he says, in order to protect us from dangers abroad during this 90-day period, I want a stay of the entry from these countries while this study is under review. And then various people in the cabinet and elsewhere report back to him to tell him the results of their study. So you might anticipate that after 90 days, he's going to put some of these restrictions in on a more permanent basis. But all he's done now is this 90-day stay, and he justifies it by citing you a provision of the Immigration and Nationality Act that gives the president a lot of authority to suspend the entry or imposition of restrictions by the president. Whenever the president finds the entry of any alien or any class of aliens into the United States would be detrimental to the interests of the United States, he may by proclamation place restrictions. Now, that's going to be the argument number one the administration lawyers are going to use to defend this action. They're going to run quickly into a statutory counterargument because the section I quoted you was put into law in 1952. In 1965, there was another provision added to this very long Immigration and Nationality Act, which on its face prohibits discrimination on visa issuance on the basis of nationality, which appears to be what's going on in this case. So we're going to have a statutory battle about how to square these two provisions. A reason I can't give you my opinion is I don't know enough about the Immigration and Nationality Act to know how, if at all, these two provisions can be reconciled with each other in this context. Only then would you reach constitutional arguments. Only then would you, say the president lost on the INA argument, that it's not authorized by statute because this non-discrimination provision prohibits it. Then some people, like Andy McCarthy and the pages of the National Review today, have said the president's actually exercising his foreign affairs power. And if the statute is read to prohibit this discrimination, the claim would have to be, even though Congress prohibits this action, I have the authority to override Congress because I'm the president of the United States. That is a very fraught argument for presidents to make. And it takes some time to sort of work through how that might come out. All I'm going to do in these introductory remarks is sort of tee that up intellectually. That's what you would ultimately get to. There's no indication yet outside of Andy McCarthy's article, however, that the president's making a constitutional override argument. He appears to be relying upon this statutory authority only. And if the president doesn't raise the constitutional claim, it would in fact never get litigated when we get to the merits of this dispute through the court system. So that's enough for me, an introductory number.
That's brilliant. Thank you so much, Chris. Walter.
I'm so pleased to see 1.5 million Duke law students turn out to for the panel this great. I mean, why am I surprised? I want to begin touching generally on subjects that I think both Neil and Steve will address in more detail, and that's to look at the constitutional question. Assuming the president would have this statutory authority, that he's not acting ultra vires, are there constitutional limitations on how he did this ban? And in particular, to look at it through the prism of the Deputy Attorney General Sally Yates, and whether she was justified in taking the position that she would direct the department not to appear and defend that order. A couple of people that I think all of us generally know and admire, Ben Wittes and Jack Goldsmith of Harvard Law School, have both argued that it was wrong for the Attorney General not to defend it on the grounds that the Department of Justice has a responsibility to defend actions of the government where there's a plausible argument. And here the plausible argument would be that there is a national security basis for halting immigration from these seven countries. And that action is presumably valid, notwithstanding the fact that each of the countries happens to be of a particular religion, would not take away the president's authority to deal in that way, and that is not a by any means a trivial argument. So the defense, in my view, would be this: that when a senior official of the administration is acting, they can take into account a broader range of considerations than perhaps even a federal district judge could, so that the Deputy Attorney General knows things and therefore knows whether this is in fact an argument that has any honesty to it. So, for example, she knows what all of us know, that is, last December 2015, the president said, and he read, speaking of himself, Donald J. Trump is calling for a total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the United States, or until we figure out what's going on. So we start with that, and it's repetition in apostolic succession. Now, suppose there was, however, a national security reason for precluding people from these seven countries. That might be fine, but suppose the Deputy Attorney General knows that there's not. Suppose she knows there haven't even been any consideration as to whether there's a national security interest in doing these people in these seven countries. And therefore, she knows that when the department's lawyers appear in court and say, it's not aimed at Muslims, it's national security, there's nothing behind that. And nothing was asserted by the president that after extensive interagency meetings involving the following national security agencies, it was concluded that there was a fresh and secure risk. None of that happened. So that I think what she might conclude, and here I'm speculating, is that you start with, we want to ban all Muslims. He rouses up his political base on that. He comes into office, finds out, of course, he can't do that for reasons both constitutional, all Muslims are prohibited, is not going to pass muster. And also for practical reasons, we have major trading and business relationships. The United States does. I won't mention anybody else that does, but the United States has major relationships with Saudi Arabia and Egypt. And you can't do it. So, but suppose he says, I got to exclude me some Muslims. Find me some. Find me some a subset that I can do. And they say, oh, great. Here's a list of seven countries that happens to have Barack Obama's name on it. Great, let's do those seven countries. Now, I'm gonna postpone telling you how irrelevant that list of seven countries is. It didn't even ban people from those countries. People from other countries that go through those have to get a visa. Countries with which we have bilateral relationships where visas are waived don't get the waiver. So that is just a pure pretense. So if you know as a senior official of the government, with access to the kind of information that a deputy attorney general would have access to as acting attorney general, that there is no national security, not only is it not the right answer, the questions haven't been asked and the study hasn't been made, you're left only with the conclusion that it is an utterly pretextual way to eliminate some. I know I can't keep all the Muslims out, but my people want as many out as we plausibly can. And here's a plausible. If that's a conclusion, then she has to say, we can't defend that because of the basis of what we know. There is no way we can go into court and ask the court to assume that which we know not to be true.
Wonderful. Neil.
Thank you, Walter. What do I call you, Guy or Professor Charles?
You could call me Guy, please.
All right, Guy.
Or as your brother from another mother.
As you were introducing us, I was thinking about what this neck brace has to do with the executive order. And actually, I think there's a lot, right? It's profoundly irritating and difficult and depressing, and yet I'm going to look for a silver lining. And the silver lining with respect to the brace is that I can't see Guy even if I tried. I want to... I really
tell
am
our mothers about that.
Yeah, I am grateful. anyway, I'm still wondering if I'm a white man in light of our relationship. But anyway, I want to thank the students. It makes me very proud to be here to see you organize and react so quickly, and to see this truly impressive turnout, as Walter. Noted. You know, there's a lot I could say. I'm going to talk about legal arguments, right? But I just want to acknowledge that I don't think it's strictly technical legal arguments that has brought all of you here, and it's certainly not that it, what has brought me here. Right? How I feel about being an American, how I feel about being a Jew, how I feel about being a teacher of Muslim students, how I feel about someone who's actually worried about terrorism, and as a non-expert, strongly suspect this is not going to make us safer, and in fact, it's going to make us less safe. That's what brings me here, but I think we all need to exercise discipline as lawyers and go through the legal vetting process in a way that I don't think the administration did in coming up with this executive order. Passion can bring you to the airport, right, but it's not going to win you a case. And in fact, as morally outraged as I or some of you may be about this, the legal arguments are quite difficult, and there are non-frivolous arguments on the other side. With respect to the two statutes, I think Chris nailed it, is how does this 1952 statute interact with the 65 statute? I am also not an immigration lawyer, and I don't know how they interact and how the courts have resolved it. A key question has to do with whether the executive order applies to immigrants, which I understand to mean lawful permanent residents, green card holders initially, right? The thought was that it did, and then the chief of staff overruled Steve Bannon or was allowed to, and I think the latest is that it doesn't apply to green card holders. And why that matters is because the 65 statute, by its terms, prohibits discrimination in the issuance of an immigrant visa because of the person's nationality and national origin, among other things. And so the president can't discriminate on the basis of nationality or national origin in granting immigrant visas, and presumably in denying entry as well, since you can't get a visa if you're not allowed to enter. But it seems to apply only to immigrants, not to temporary visitors like students, guest workers, tourists, refugees, nor does the statute prohibit discrimination on the basis of religion. And so to the extent the order continues not to apply to immigrants under federal immigration law, that suggests to me that the foreign affairs power is not going to be triggered, and this is going to turn on the constitutional claims. Again, I don't know, but that's the best sense I could make of the statutory regime in the time that I had. As for the constitutional challenges, I think the strongest one immediately is the Establishment Clause. I think it's the best one as well. Discrimination among religions is not permitted under the Establishment Clause. See Larson against Valente, 1982 decision. Quote, the clearest command of the Establishment Clause is that one religious denomination cannot be officially preferred over another. There's evidence on the face of the executive order that one religion is being preferred over another. The seven countries are predominantly Muslim. The order also talks about the need to combat radical Islamic terrorism. I don't see why terrorism itself is not enough. There's a preference in the text of the order for religious minorities, which the president told Christian broadcast radio, that that was in there to mean that Christians will be preferred over Muslims. It's also true that the order doesn't facially target other Muslim countries, and so there are arguments on the other side. Nonetheless, there's textual evidence. And then when you go to the extra textual evidence, the smoking gun evidence is overwhelming, right? So Walter gave you the first quote, right? A complete ban on Muslims entering until we figure out what is going on. July 2016, he effectively admits on national TV that he's replacing the word Muslim with nationality in order to get around objections, right? This is with NBC's Chuck Todd. Trump said he would target immigrants from certain countries, but resisted the suggestion that this was a retreat from his proposal to target Muslims. I actually don't think it's a rollback. In fact, you can say it's an expansion. People were so upset when I used the word Muslim. Oh, you can't use the word Muslim. Remember this, and I'm okay with that because I'm talking territory instead of Muslim. So he's already told you on national TV it's a pretext. Then you go to November 2015. He told NBC News he would certainly implement a database to track Muslims in the U.S. I would certainly implement that, absolutely. Would Muslims be legally required to register? They would have to be. They have to be. March 2016, he says, and again, this is in public, frankly, look, we're having problems with the Muslims, and we're having problems with Muslims coming into the country. So the smoking gun extra textual evidence by the very person who signed the order it seems to me, to make an overwhelming case under the Establishment Clause and the Free Exercise Clause. The Free Exercise Clause prohibits the government, including the president, from intentionally targeting a religious group here, Muslims. They don't have to name the religion, right? By name, it's enough that there is an anti-religious bias, similar to the equal protection rules for discriminatory purpose under Washington against Davis and personnel administrator against Feeney. It's enough that this is being done in part because of its impact on Muslims and not despite it. See, for example, Church of Lakumi Babalui against City of Hialeah. In that case, there was an ordinance prohibiting this animal sacrifice, and the context made clear that this was done because of this one minority religion who engaged in animal sacrifice. Other arguments, which I think I'm less confident about, but I think are plausible given how extraordinary this order is, fall under the Fifth Amendment's Due Process Clause. First, there is the procedural due process concerns about the people who are caught on the plane or in the airports. And if they have a visa, then you know, that's a property interest. That's a legal entitlement. Right? There was no notice. Presumably, there has to be a hearing. So there's the procedural due process challenge in the short run. In terms of the long run, or the longer run, and this is something that would not ordinarily go anywhere, but again, this is not an ordinary case. When I think about this order and I think about the lack of consultation within the executive branch, which is now a matter of public record, the way in which the justification, national security, who's on the list, which countries are on, which countries are off, it's so wildly under and over inclusive. Saudi Arabia and Egypt are not included. The ambiguity in who this applies to, right? Is it, I mean, you would think that it would be clear whether it applies to green card holders or not. When I think about all this together, I think about arbitrary and capricious. And I don't mean the Administrative Procedure Act, which doesn't apply to the president. I mean due process, which does apply to the president. Again, ordinarily, I don't think a court would go for this, but this is so poorly drafted. And it so doesn't make sense with respect to the stated purpose that I think it's a problem. And then the last thing I'll say, and I'll stop, is equal protection principles protected under the Fifth Amendment's Due Process Clause. And I'm thinking specifically about the animus doctrine used repeatedly in gay rights cases, which to my mind actually sounds in social meaning more than actual animus, although I think animus is present here. Again, if this is not a smoking gun, then what is? I want you to compare what Senators McCain and Graham had to say about this order with how Justice Kennedy writes about DOMA and U.S. against Windsor. So McCain and Graham, this executive order sends a signal, intended or not, that America does not want Muslims coming into our country. I mean, Tony Kennedy could have written that. They would probably be aghast to know, right, that they were channeling Anthony Kennedy. But this is Kennedy in the Windsor case, which invalidated federal law's limitation of marriage to opposite-sex couples. DOMA undermines both the public and private significance of state-sanctioned same-sex marriages, for it tells those couples, it sends a signal, and all the world, that their otherwise valid marriages are unworthy of federal recognition. This places same-sex couples in an unstable position of being in a second-tier marriage. The differentiation demeans the couple whose moral and sexual choices the Constitution protects, see Lawrence against Texas, and whose relationship the state has sought to dignify, and it humiliates tens of thousands of children now being raised by same-sex couples. So I can almost see, right, the pivotal justice on the court, regardless of whether this nomination succeeds for the time being, writing an opinion that's very much like the public utterance of these two very important Republicans in the Senate.
That was awesome. Thank you, brother. David Schanzer.
Actually, Neil, could I ask you a question? If on the religious discrimination issue, which I think is, you know, as you say, incredibly blatant and discriminatory, is that enough to bring the whole thing down? Or, I mean, could they just say, mm-hmm. well, you can't, in implementing this order, you obviously can't preference right. Christians over Muslims, but if you don't do that, then it's okay.
Right. It's an excellent question. I neglected to mention it. An advantage of the Establishment Clause, I should say, is that the lack standing rules, right? Even though they've been narrowed, taxpayer, if you're going to be just using public funds to prefer certain religions over others, right, there's very broad standing. So that's an advantage. But to answer your question, it's not clear to me it would take down the whole order. I think it would take, it might take down the seven countries, right, predominantly Muslim, that part of the order. I think it would take down the, once we start up with the refugee and the admissions process again, preferring Muslims over Christians, but the specific targeting of Syrian refugees, putting a hold on all refugees, I mean, a court would have to say that the whole thing is infected with anti-Muslim bias. And I mean, that's, you could do it under the Establishment Clause, you could do it under the Equal Protection component of the Due Process Clause, but it's not obvious that the whole thing would go down. I think there are important parts of it that would. I think a court would have to be persuaded that really just the whole, you can't really sever the bigoted parts from the non-bigoted parts. This whole thing, you can't argue that what's the surprise he's making good on a campaign promise with, you know, whatever I said during the campaign was then, and now this is governance, this is different, right? So I think you'd have to say that everything is infected by the constitutional defect.
Okay, well, thank you for letting me ask a question. With a former Assistant Attorney General for Legal Policy and a former Acting Solicitor General and a former Supreme Court clerk on our panel, I am not going to opine on the constitutional issues today, although I do have a law degree that's been gathering a bit of dust for the last decade or so, although I brush it off every once in a while. I just want to say a few words about why this executive order is just rotten security policy. And I'm going to whip through some of these arguments. But number one, and the most, to me, the most troubling and the only thing to say is sad, is that it's really marking a U.S. withdrawal from its classic traditional leadership role, really in the post-World War II order. There is not a major security issue that has affected the globe, I don't think it's an understatement, since World War II, that the United States has not been deeply involved in and in usually taking the forefront in addressing. We provide leadership, we often provide resources, we'll provide our military force if necessary, military equipment and know-how if necessary. We bring our alliance building capability, and we bring the power of our ideas. And what this executive order says, in extent, is, well, we have a huge migration crisis, which is crippling our main allies in the world, Europe and NATO, and indeed is fomenting so much discord that it is challenging the existence, the continued existence of the EU. So this huge problem, and what is the United States going to do to help address it, to mitigate it, to show leadership? Zero. We're not going to admit any refugees for the next 4 months, and then we don't know. We're an indefinite ban on refugees from Syria. How tragic, how sad, how much of an abdication of our moral role in this world. And you put that together in the same week with bailing out on the TPP, leaving China to be the economic leader in Asia, all these countries that are terrified of being dominated militarily and economically by China, and you add to that disintegrating our relationship with Mexico on our southern border, you see a sense of the United States not standing up to what it's been as a source of stability. And I think, listen, we could have a big debate about bad things the U.S. has done in foreign policy. That's a great debate to have. But I think as a force for good in creating a stable, secure, prosperous world since the Second World War. And what really makes us different from Russia, from China? They both have big nuclear arsenals. China has a pretty darn big economy. Russia is not quite as strong. But it's our alliances. Those countries don't have any alliances. They don't have any friends. That's why we're so much powerful. We're disintegrating our alliances through these series of actions. And why is it that we have allies? Why do people want to be allies with us? It's not just because we have a very strong military. It's not just because we have a very strong economy. It's because we have shown over and over and over again that we are willing to make sacrifices. Sometimes it's our troops, sometimes it's money, sometimes it's some of our power, sometimes we're willing to sacrifice our power for the betterment of others. And we know that in the long run that we'll benefit as well. So what this is, this executive order says, we're so scared that one or two people might slip into the United States and engage in some level of violence. We're not willing to take even that tiny risk to help our allies, to help our world, to help our region deal with an enormous crisis and suffering. It's a tragedy. It really is a tragedy. That's the message. Trump is that we're all out for ourselves. It's America first. It's all about economics and what we can leverage and gain out of these alliances. And it's not about sacrifice for the betterment of any. You never hear anything about that. What did Nikki Haley say in the United Nations this week? He said, if you're not helping us, if you're not out, if you don't have America's back, we're taking names. What kind of foreign policy is that for a great nation? It's a tragedy. Second, this executive order has done something that Osama bin Laden, ISIS, Mr. Baghdadi could not achieve. And what was that? That was to drive a wedge between the United States and the world's 1.2 billion Muslims, one out of every five people on this earth. How can that be in our national interest? Whether this is a ban or is an unconstitutional discrimination, again, that's for others. It doesn't matter. The damage is done. We have disparaged Muslims. We have disparaged Islam. The current president of the United States did it consistently through the campaign. He had an opportunity become president to say, well, I was just rhetoric. I just did that for votes. Now I'm serious. Now I'm governance. Okay? But this is more of the same. Throughout his speech discussing, announcing this, what did he keep saying? We don't want them here. He didn't go on and say, well, we don't want Libyans and we don't want Syrians. He kept saying, we don't want them. How stupid do they think that we are, not knowing who he was saying when he meant them? Now, we can't address problems in the Middle East. We can't prevent terrorism around the world without the help of whom? Muslims. How are we going to get intelligence from these countries? How are we going to, who is fighting with us in ISIS, against ISIS? Kurds and Iraqis. Who is dealing with problems in various places around the Middle East? We have allies, whether it's in Iraq, dealing with the civil war in Yemen, trying to suppress Boko Haram in Nigeria. Who do we think the Nigerian army is? Well, they're all Muslims. So how does it help us to have this executive order, which is so blatantly discriminatory and is insulting every Muslim on the planet? And not only that, it is ratifying the exact strategy of Al-Qaeda and ISIS. How is it doing that? What do they want to tell Muslims? They want to say to you, you know what, forget these Western ideals of peace and toleration and individuality and freedom of religion. Forget about all of that. Those are not going to get you to the promised land. Those are not consistent with Islam. Scrap that and come and fight with us. there's no place for you in the West. If you want to be a good Muslim, if you want to really abide by the Quran as the way the Prophet Muhammad wrote it or received it in the 7th century, we're the only real deal. It's the caliphate or nothing. As a matter of fact, you're blaspheming yourself by living in the West, by adopting Western values, by believing in anything that the West does. And what are we saying? We are saying, Trump is saying the exact same thing when he says that we don't want you here. He's saying there's no place for you in the West. We don't share your values. So he's encouraging the very same rhetoric, the very same argument, and they'll use it, you can be sure. They're going to say, you can see the Twitters or the commercials or the videos that ISIS will create. You see, they're letting Christians that are escaping the butchery of Bashar al-Assad, they're letting them come to the United States, but not you. Not you, the Sunnis who are being slaughtered by Assad and the Russians. They're getting in, but you're not. Why would you side with them? So the only way, and it's going to hurt us, of course, with homegrown terrorism as well. I mean, we don't know why the small number of Americans who've had the advantages of living here, whether they're Muslims, whether they're direct immigrants, second-generation immigrants, born here, immigrated here as young kids, as refugees. The bottom line is we really don't know what clicks the switch, but it's very small numbers of people. But one thing we should believe we know is that it's about people who seem to do these things have a real conflict with their identity. They lack a secure feeling about who they are, what their place is in the world, what their future is. Are they Muslim? Are they American? And this kind of lack of a strong identity is often what characterizes people who then fall into the radicalization. They adopt the ideology, they look at it on the internet, and they engage in the violent incidents that we know. Of POTUS, if the President of the United States, I'm going to wrap up right now, if the President is saying, and he's surrounding himself also in his cabinet, in his White House, with people who are saying, we don't want you, you're not real Americans, that is the kind of message that can, either push more people into that category where they're vulnerable, or push those vulnerable people over the edge. So we're exposing ourselves to more danger from what everybody in our intelligence community says is the number one threat to us in terms of terrorism. It's not people coming from Syria and organizing a cell and attacking us here, but it is the homegrown violent extremism that we see from lone wolves who get a gun and enter a crowded place and start shooting. I have a number of other reasons, but I'm sure we'll get to them in the questions. So this is a rotten piece of policy that's actually going to make us much more dangerous, not any safer.
Thank you so much, David. Thank you. Stephen.
Thank you very much. I very much appreciate the opportunity to participate. Unfortunately, will not help answer the topic today, can he do that? And it may seem, unfortunately, that many of us are sort of in the same boat. The statutory argument is hard, figuring out whether one provision of 8 USC deals with another provision of 8 USC is not immediately obvious. The constitutional argument is at least a little bit hard, both because the facts are at the very least in dispute, not, people may feel that there are clear answers one way or another, but sort of knowing exactly what is in the heart of the administration officials as an instrument assigned, and also what role that plays in the constitutional analysis. I think that some of the constitutional arguments would in fact be difficult ones, in any circumstance other than the most clear-cut discriminatory intent. I furthermore will not address the policy issues of surrounding the executive order, both as to the process by which it was issued, which has been criticized by many and as to its substance, whether its effects on the United States' global reputation, on the affected individuals abroad, and also the message that it sends to American citizens. What I will talk about is the response led to the rather extraordinary events in the last 24 hours, I suppose, involving the order by Acting Attorney General Yates to the Department of Justice not to defend or present arguments in defense of the executive order, and then her removal by the president. And try to give a general overview. In my view, you know, as someone without, you know, without taking any position on the merits of the legal arguments or of the order itself, in my view, what Acting Attorney General Yates did was wrong. But it was almost framed in a way that could have been correct, and I hope to explain what I mean by that. The Constitution vests the executive power of the United States in a single person, the President of the United States of America. And that single person is obligated to take care that the laws are faithfully executed. Obviously, they can't do that all by themselves. The Constitution provides for the creation of other offices by statute, which can then be filled by appointment, to carry out the many things that the United States needs to do. The officers who appointed thereby, there's a long-running debate in administrative law of sort of who exactly their boss is. To what extent is their boss? Are they officers of the president? Are they officers of Congress? Are they officers of the law or just of the United States generally, as the Constitution often refers to them? A few things are reasonably clear. One is that as an officer appointed by the president or by and confirmed by the Senate or by one of the other appointment means that the Constitution sets out, cannot actually do anything illegal. You cannot violate the law, even if the president tells you to. A great case from early 1800s, Little versus Berriam, you know, Thomas Jefferson, I believe, said, stop this category of ship involved with the embargo to France, which was a category not allowed to be stopped by statute. An officer did so, got sued, said, hey, the president told me to do it. Court said, great, we don't care. President cannot tell you to violate the law. If you violate the law, you are subject to a tort suit, whatever else might happen to you. The president's job is to execute the laws. The president cannot suspend or override the laws. That said, you have two problems associated with what would otherwise seem like a relatively clear-cut answer. The president can order you to do things only if it's lawful. One is, sometimes the law is unclear. So what do you do if you're an officer and you're not sure whether what the president told you to do is legal or not? Do you owe any deference to the president's opinion? How do you act? In a lot of circumstances, we think that subordinates within an organization do owe a certain amount of deference. For instance, the rules of professional conduct in most jurisdictions have special provisions for what an associate should do when they're told by the partner, make this legal argument. And they're not sure whether that legal argument, in fact, would be frivolous or, in fact, might go outside their duty of candor to the court. They're supposed to talk to their superior about that in most jurisdictions. And in certain circumstances, they might be fulfilling, they might be within their ethical obligations to do something, even if all else being equal, they would think that it violates their ethical obligations if they have first cleared it with their superior in the organization. The rules themselves might be set up that way. In other circumstances, following orders is no defense. And so the law in, you know, the law might well say you act at your peril when you take someone else's legal interpretation in place of your own. A second problem that we have is that in addition to problems of pure legal uncertainty, there's also a distinction between doing something illegal and making a legal argument in court that might be wrong. So for instance, the law might say, if the executive order is unlawful, it might say, therefore, that someone trying to enter the United States, who otherwise would have permission to do so, should not be stopped, and that the officer stopping them is violating the law. That is a separate question from whether, if a lawsuit is filed by someone seeking to enter the United States, and the Department of Justice line attorney shows up to defend it, whether they are able to make an argument that they think may not be a winning argument, but they think is a perfectly reasonable argument in defense of the administration's positions. Also, you know, you'll often see in professional responsibility context, lawyers sometimes make arguments they do not agree with. And if they did not, the legal system would quickly grind to a halt. Everyone who has been in practice has had the experience of having a client make an argument. It is within their legal, is within the zone of reasonableness. They are allowed to make that argument in court, and a lawyer can make it whether or not they think that's the best argument. In this case, I think that what Acting Attorney General Yates did was wrong, specifically because she did not make what, to my mind, is a sort of condition precedent finding to an order to the line attorneys at the Department of Justice not to enforce a statute. What Yates said was, at present, I am not convinced that the defense of the executive order is consistent with these responsibilities, namely the department's responsibilities to seek justice and stand for what is right, nor am I convinced the executive order is lawful. It seems to me that the standard has to be much higher than that. It's not merely a question that one is unconvinced that an order is lawful. One must have, at the very least, the firm belief that an order is unlawful before one deprives the executive branch of the opportunity to defend it in court. For example, think of what would happen if a line attorney at the Department of Justice disagreed with Yates and thought, in fact, that the order was within the president's powers. It would be very strange if, at each chain in the chain of command, mere uncertainty would allow the attorney next in line to depart from the orders of someone who is very clearly their superior. Trump is Yates' superior, was until her removal. And if Yates did not have the belief that an order she received from her legal superior was unlawful, then it was her duty to carry it out. Now, it may well be that her statement was merely one of understatement, that she actually believes it to be unlawful. She believes it to be unlawful for all the reasons that Professor Dellinger articulated, and just didn't want to say that in the statement. That is a possibility. It's an extremely charitable reading of the statement. I think it is too charitable a reading of the statement. And in any case, I think that she would have done the country a great service by saying so, if her belief was that this was motivated by bias and prejudice and therefore is unconstitutional. Having the acting attorney general say that would be very significant, and it would have helped the public deliberation to know what to do next. The fact that that was not said in an environment where it could have been said makes me less certain that she was convinced of that fact. One further note that I want to make. If you are convinced that an order is unlawful, there are a variety of options that one has in responding to it. And there are different circumstances under which different responses are appropriate. I'll say more about that in Q&A if you're interested. But one option that's always available to you is to resign. And that is available to you not just when you think that you've been given an order that's unlawful, but also when you think you've been given an order that is not, as she says, wise or just. It is not the job of the Attorney General to refuse to enforce a lawful order of the president because you think it is unwise. It is perfectly within your rights, though, to resign. There are other lawyers in the Department of Justice. The world can get on without you, and if you, as we have seen, and if you think that you're being asked to do something that you do not want to do, that you think harms our country, and that you think may very well be unlawful, even if you're not completely sure, resignation is a perfectly plausible response thereto. That was not what happened. Instead, Yates ordered line attorneys not to enforce what might still, even on her own account, have been a lawful order of the president. I think that was an incorrect way to carry out her duties, and for that reason, she was removed.
Thank you, Stephen. So all of this was a great model of amazing legal analysis and policy analysis. So what we're going to do is open it up.